So we initially planned this panel, or I should say Jeff, who deserves the credit for doing the lion's share of planning work, planned this panel perhaps with a different outcome in mind. But with that said, there are perhaps even more issues to be covered than there were when it was initially being conceived. But we're thinking about, and we're of course never going to be able to cover every question and every issue. With that said, though, we're kind of revolving our questions around three main themes tonight. The first question would be, how has the 2016 election cycle changed expectations or norms about the electoral process in future elections in the United States? And of course, inextricably linked to that is, how do racism and sexism inform this process in the United States? The second question is, from the perspective of progressive politics or politics on the left, what prospects do we have for progress for moving forward under a Trump administration? And the third question is, given that the campaign with fairly overt messages of hatred and prejudice won at least the electoral vote, what are the sources of hope that we can look for moving forward? So we're going to go down the line of panelists, and they've each devised opening statements. And after about a half hour of conversation, then we'll open it up to questions in the audience. There are different ways to ask questions. First, we've got note cards if you'd like to write your questions. It looks like Jeff is going to distribute the note cards as the panel progresses. The other option is to just raise your hand and we'll bring the microphone out to you. And it may take a moment because we're in a rather crowded space. With that said, though, we are recording both the audio and the visual of this forum. And so we'll ask you to wait until the microphone comes to you. And we are, even though our panelists are perfectly capable of projecting, we're also imposing on them to speak into the microphone so that, you know, to the thousands in the studio audience and the millions watching live at home, we all will be able to hear this, hear the audio of this great discussion. So, with no further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce the panelists. Sitting on my left is Stellan Vinthagen. He is the chair in the study of nonviolent direct action in civil resistance and professor of sociology at UMass Amherst. Hello, Stellan. We also have Professor Uditi Sen, who is a professor of South Asian Studies and History at Hampshire College, and also author of the forthcoming book, Citizen Refugee, Forging the Indian Nation After Partition. Thank you, Professor Sen. Our third panelist is Marc Daalder, who is a writer and student at Amherst College. Marc has been published in the Financial Times, in the Chicago Reader, In These Times, and more. And our final panelist is Professor Vijay Prashad, who is professor of international studies at Trinity College, editor of Left Word Books, and if you read this piece this week, a frequent comedic writer for the Daily Hampshire Gazette. Thank you, Professor Prashad. So Stellan has graciously agreed to go first, and it seems like he's mapped out a whole mess of stuff to say. So Stellan, let's kick it off with you.
Thank you so much. Let's see now if the sound works okay for you. Yeah? All right. So you have to live with my Swenglish. I'm a Viking that is coming from Scandinavia, and I'm part of the new Viking invasion into United States. Peaceful one this time. So we live in a very dangerous time right now with the result of the election. But I will also describe this as a crisis with opportunities. So we see a lot of protests going on right now. That is hopeful. It's very clear that people are getting mobilized and there is a willingness for resistance. At the same time, I don't think that quickly embarking on protests is really what we need right now. I'm doubtful that we need to have protests against the result of an election we don't like, when the election was fair and just. I think what we are shocked about and depressed about is that Clinton lost. But I would say that what we should be hopeful about and what is the crisis and opportunity here is that Clinton lost. I am understanding what happened as a loss for the mainstream, for the Washington elite, if you understand what I mean. I think that the success of Trump was more the failure of Clinton. Because if you look on the votes that Trump got, it was less than the loser in the last president election. It was really Clinton that didn't succeed to get the votes. And we should remember that Bernie rallied a lot of support. And Bernie is also an unlikely comparison with Trump, but is also a revolt against the mainstream in Washington. I'm coming from Europe, and I might have a little bit different view here. And for me, Clinton is associated with the US empire, with interventionism, militarization, and the unconditional support of US influence around in the world. I am perhaps a bit too optimistic here, but I am going to maintain that perhaps we're seeing something of like the beginning of the end of the US empire and the defense of the US republic. I think we're seeing similar things as these shocking results that we've seen in the United States, also in other parts of the world, and I'm thinking primarily on Europe here, with the victory of Corbyn, a left-wing Labour leader in the UK, with Brexit, with Podemos in Spain, and Syriza in Greece. These are both right-wing and left-wing populism that are revolting against business as usual. So I think we need to take a step back and think about strategies. We need to develop a strategy for the coming 4 years, not embark on protests directly. So I will say a couple of reflections on strategies, and I'll try to keep the time limit. In order to have strategies that are new and fresh, we also need to think about how do we develop new visions. Visions of a better society, a different and attractive society that can attract also the white working class, that can attract people that have now put their confidence to Trump. With new visions, we would have a compass and an orientation of where to go. But in order to implement that, we need to have a strategy. And I'm suggesting a simple one where we are thinking in terms of first step is until the midterm election in 2 years. The next step is for the next president election in 4 years. And the third step is what we can do with hopefully a less reactionary president in place after 4 years. We have an opportunity to build strong social movements out of the anger and the dangerous time we live in now as a reaction against Trump. We should build movements for these longer term of more than 4 years. With campaigns that have clear targets, creative tactics, that educate a new generation of activists and leaders and organizers, then we will stand in a much better situation out of these dangerous times when hopefully someone else that is more progressive are in the White House. And I'm thinking about three key areas where we could focus our campaigns. I'm thinking about democratization. Many people are frustrated about the lack of democracy in the US. I must confess that I'm a bit surprised that there are still people that really regard United States as being a democracy. According to a Princeton study in 2004, United States is not a democracy. United States is ruled by a number of elites, economic elites, that are actually running this country. And we have all the issues around the Electoral College, all the voting restrictions, how money is playing a role in politics to the level of extensive corruption. These are some of the issues that Trump have skillfully used in the revolt against Washington. But we need new visions about a democracy that would be something else, that would go deeper, that would mean something more for people. I come from a country where if you're a citizen over a certain age, you get a letter at home where you have your voting papers. You don't have to register. In this country, there are so many restrictions. So there are many things that could be increased in terms of democratization. Secondly, equality. US is a very unequal country. The 1% has been a household name or concept created by the Occupy. Obama are using it, and it's now used everywhere. But the working poor in this country, the unemployed in this country, the people that live in the rural areas that are vulnerable for a society that is not having any kind of welfare state, they are the ones in high degree that supports Trump. That should be the left or the liberals that are actually mobilizing these people. It should, and it has been at other times in history. It could be again. But then there needs to be a vision and a kind of mobilization from the Democrats or hopefully a third, more radical party that could actually mobilize that in a clear way. In the same way with racism as being so prevalent in this country is part of the problem with inequality in this country. And lastly, I want to mention climate. Naomi Klein, I think, have made a very important point about that radical social change is not longer something for the extremists. Radical social change is absolutely, totally necessary for our survival. So suddenly, radical social change is what is needed in order to actually survive as a humankind and deal with climate change. I think that will also open up something if we have visions, if we have strategies of how to implement that radical social change. So the last two things I want to say is the two strategic keys that I see for moving forward with this, and that is to combine resistance and the building up of alternatives. I think we need resistance against injustices, but we also need to build up alternatives and alliances of things that are attractive, that are solutions, that are things that brings people to our kind of movements in order to that they see that we are having some kind of solution, some kind of way forward. We cannot only be critical. That would create the polarization and a crisis that is a productive one, a one where we have the people against the elites. That's the kind of polarization and crisis we need. The problem with the polarization and crisis we have today is that we have a large segment of people against a large segment of people. That is really bad for any of these progressive changes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stellan. Professor Sen.
Thank you. I hope my sound is the sound is okay. All right. So today I'm going to speak about. My name is Professor Uditi Sen. I teach South Asian studies, and in terms of where I'm coming from, I live in the skin I live in. I own a uterus. I'm queer. I have a partner who's Jewish. I'm an immigrant on insecure visa status. And I'm currently being filmed saying what I'm saying in Trump's America. And it's not entirely funny. I'm saying it as a joke because that's the only framework in which I can say it. So my talk today will be that if you are going to talk about where do we go from here, we have to take a long, hard look at who the we is. Mm-hmm. And our strategies to be effective have to be sensitive to that we. And I'll keep it largely practical, but I'll start from a point of departure. I'm usually an optimist. However, in this situation, I find myself breaking ranks with optimists who are hoping that Trump's election is an opportunity or a possibility to bring back to the fold of progressive politics people who have once voted for Democrats and have now gone for Trump, right? And particularly the assumption is that these are people who have voted mainly for economic reasons, not for the racism, the homophobia, the sexism, which Trump has clearly stood for. This assumption is flawed. I assure you, touching, knowing, or even marrying or voting for a black person doesn't immediately take away xenophobia or homophobia. It doesn't work in that way, right? So, and this has been part of the mainstream NPR narrative that, you know, therefore, that is the only evidence I've seen that the people have not been attracted by the racist message because once upon a time they voted for Obama. That is not how racism works. That is not how discrimination works. How it works, however, is to mobilize people against people. And people have been mobilized against people because the war has come home to roost. Because I'm an educator. I'm almost tempted to ask how many people in this room know that how many countries America is voting, bombing? Five, right? How many times did that come up in the election?
Zero,
right? It's a fundamentally anti-democratic way of not just running USA, but running the world. And it has to be contained within a democratic framework. The only way this can be done is by turning people against people. And as long as there are ingrained ideas of racism or xenophobia, let's say nativism, as long as there are ingrained ideas of nativism in various countries, be it England, be it USA, be it Brexit, be it a Trump, you know, be it an anti-Muslim Hindu fundamentalist leader in India, Modi, as long as there's a section of the population which legitimately believes that somehow they were owed more, somehow they were not meant to suffer. As long as this idea exists, talking about economics is not going to enable us to stop the war being brought home. It is an effective strategy to win elections by the elite by actually changing nothing and using the media to garner votes. It is a very effective strategy. It's working, right? And if we cannot look it in the face in terms of that the substratum of the strategy is prejudice which already exists in society, if we somehow think, and especially in a country built on slavery and genocide, if we somehow make ourselves believe that there are no prejudices which have to be undone, this conversation is already over. Today, while the North Dakota pipeline struggle is on, today, while the Black Lives Matter struggle is on, if we somehow make ourselves believe that we are not going to be able to even hold the line, right? So that is kind of my, and I think what is happening among a lot of my progressive friends, and these are friends of mine, it's almost a kind of, you know, desperate optimism. We are hoping that the right wing will do our work for us. It won't. We are hoping that a right wing rebellion will lead to left wing consequences. It won't. It's going to be hard work, it's going to be a lot of work, and we'll need to start building broad-based alliances. What gives me hope is that a national Muslim-Jewish alliance was announced. I don't want to know what kind of differences they decided not to talk about. Right? I don't know what enabled that alliance. right? But this is a practical alliance. This is a perception that we are living in at a time of emergency. We need to hold the line, right? And there's another, that's also some forms of reassurance which I've been given that, oh, he didn't mean it, he just said it to get elected. I'm like, what do you think scares me more? One bigot in Washington or somebody who's not a bigot but had to say this because the entire electorate is bigoted? And these have been my friends who have been reassuring me in this way, but I assure you, none of them are people of color who have been reassuring me. There is a disparity in perception. There is fear for people who have insecure visa status. There are people who are finding it difficult to breathe. So what we have to acknowledge is that until January, there's a state of emergency for a lot of people. What can we do? Who are you? I'm coming here from a visa appointment. I'm trying to rush my visa renewal through. Right? If you're me, go rush your visa, like talk to your lawyer. If you are a lawyer, offer your services to those who need it. If you are, you know, an educator, you've got your work cut out for you because children are not hypocrites. Right? So the Southern Poverty Law Center has shown the primary site of spike in racism is schools, K-12 schools. Right? So it's educators and largely women who'll have to clean up after Trump. Right, and they're trying to do that, cleaning up. After that, it comes universities. So if you're a lawyer, if you're an educator, that is the work we have to immediately start doing because that work is urgent, that work is immediate. It's cut out for us whether we are white or POC or anything. And as for going forward, where do we look? I found it astounding that there was not a single analysis, in-depth analysis of what possible impact the 2013 repealing of the Voters' Rights Act could have had on this election. And the amount of focus, so a quarter of America voted, and a small percentage of that turned from Democrat to Trump, not to Republican, to Trump, and they're all white. And all we want to do is redeem them. So I want to show you this graph. The declining line is the Democratic vote. And I can bet my salary that is largely not white. Why are we focusing on this one demographic who's turned? Where is the media focus on people who don't have IDs, people who do not have access to voting? Where is the media analysis on what could have been the possible impact of the repeal of the Voters' Rights Act? So we have to take a long, hard look at who we are, what our assumptions is making us focus on. If we're going to win this battle, we need to decolonize ourselves. Because if we don't do that, it's not going to happen. But what I would say is until January, it's a state of emergency. Those of you who can offer your services, offer your services. Those of you who are vulnerable, find resources. Transgender people, get your name through. I know queer people who are desperately trying to adopt their own children before Trump comes in. Anybody who's an immigrant is rushing to kind of get their visa thing, because guess what? We don't want to wait and see whether your guess is that he doesn't mean it is right or not. Seems like a little too much at stake. So and those of you who can offer your services, do offer your services. And I'd say the war has come home, because I think even the left has got used to the idea of collateral damage. So what we are facing today is that, yes, Trump can be a revolution, but guess what? It's going to have collateral damage. Now the question is, as a society, are we going to accept this collateral damage of, you know, either Muslims being registered, or, you know, people with uterus losing health services, or, you know, queer people having their families torn apart, or immigrants having their families torn apart? There's not a chance in hell he's not going to do any one of these four things. If I had to take a guess, I'll say he'll go for the Muslims. That's the most expendable part of the American political system, the smallest part. So what we have to ask ourselves is, what do we find acceptable as collateral damage in our journey towards transformation of American democracy?
Thank you so much, Professor Sen. Now to Marc Daalder.
Yeah. So I guess I want to go off of what you said, Professor Sen, about... Oh, I'm Marc Daalder. I'm a student at Amherst College. I'm studying history there, and I write for a number of publications, including In These Times and the Jewish Daily Forward, where I'm a sort of pretty frequent contributor. I want to go off of what Professor Sen said about optimists and pessimists, and I think one of the dangers of optimism with regards to Trump as president is in normalizing these things that shouldn't be normalized. So Trump goes on 60 Minutes on Sunday, and people come to me and they say he looked presidential, he looked normal, he said that his supporters should stop being violent, and I ask, you know, is that the low bar that we give him now? You say, don't be violent, and you look normal. And no one mentions that he also called in the same interview or said that he was going to deport 2 to 3 million people. That's sort of glossed over because, look, you know, at least he's not saying racial slurs like on national television. And I think this is a danger that sort of impacts every part of the politics that are sort of to come, whether it's domestic policy or foreign policy. As long as Trump sort of meets just below like our worst fears, we'll all sort of shrug and nod and say, okay, you know, he only deported 2 to 3 million people, not 11 million people. Or, you know, he only moved the U.S. embassy to Jerusalem, not to East Jerusalem. Or, you know, he killed a lot of terrorists and a lot of civilians, but at least he didn't kill all of the families of all of the terrorists in Syria. And I think, I don't know, it's a little bit of exaggeration, but it's also something that I think you can see and that we will see in especially sort of the mainstream media over the next 4 years is as Trump sort of just barely rises above our extremely low bar and our extremely low expectations for him. People, whether in the mainstream or on the progressive left, will sort of rejoice that he hasn't like met our deepest and darkest fears. And I think that that sort of oversimplification of what's going on in terms of seeing things as good and bad is what we fear the most and good is anything else, is also sort of being applied to the election in terms of people seeing it solely as a matter of economic sort of difficulties coming up within the white working class, and that's why the election was lost, or solely as sort of a vast swath of Midwestern and Southern states wherein every single sort of poor voter voted due to racial grievance, because a lot of people did vote for Obama, and I think more importantly, a lot of people voted for Hillary still this election, just not a majority. And so there, it's not as if to go into those states is... A majority did vote in the popular vote, but I was referring specifically to like the Midwestern states and the Southern states where Hillary lost. Still a large percentage of people did vote for her there. So it's not as if going into that we'll be encountering a solely sort of Trump-supporting base. There are people there that already voted for Hillary that are already progressives and leftists that you can talk to and work with and who are already sort of embedded in these communities, if that's sort of the route you want to go. But I think there's just so many different causes for what happened to this election. And I think if any one little thing had gone a little bit differently, perhaps Trump wouldn't be president. For voter suppression, there are 300,000 registered voters in Wisconsin who couldn't get their sort of appropriate IDs by election day, and Hillary ended up losing Wisconsin by 27,000 votes. So voter ID laws and voter suppression, had those been just a little bit different, perhaps Hillary would have won. If she had, but I think the biggest mistake Hillary made was her pitch to, her pitch was oriented to the wrong culture, I think. I think the election, if you want to simplify it to economic or racial terms, I think you should simplify it to cultural terms. And the idea that Hillary made her pitch to a sort of liberal culture and a sort of elite culture, and people like me at least, where when I watched her during the debate rolling her eyes at what Trump was saying, I sort of chuckled to myself. But I think there are people who were listening and thought that that was almost infantile. And it's just the recognition that the United States has a number of different cultures which are racist and which are sexist, all of them, whether liberal culture or sort of conservative culture or anything else, and that do need to be decolonized. but that also needs to sort of be recognized and grappled with on an individual basis. So I guess those are my two points, sort of the idea of normalization and the idea of sort of oversimplification of the election results and of activism going forward.
Thank you, Mark. Professor Vijay Prashad, remember to introduce yourself.
Yes, good evening. I know, otherwise I'll get chided by Carolyn over here. I teach at Trinity College and I live in Northampton. And for 598 days, I covered the US election for two periodicals. 598 days. 598 days. I can't tell you how many rallies I attended and how much my psyche was damaged by them. So this is not really something to say flippantly, but I think it's a fair question to ask about the nature of American democracy. It's basically become a reality television show. It's a place where people come to live out their worst nightmares in public, whether it's the liberals who come to cheer and disdain others or the right-wing bigots who come out there to flout their bigotry. 598 days not to have a serious discussion about the serious problems that plague this country, but basically like sports teams to sit on one side or the other in a pep rally. It's 598 days of pep rally. Yes, there's voter suppression. I think that's important. But, I mean, there's also mind-numbing democracy suppression, where people are just exhausted. I mean, I felt that people were voting by early ballot just so they could get this damn thing over as quickly as possible. So they didn't have to wait till standing in line. And, you know, they just want... I wanted this over. I had, of course, a professional reason for it to end. Although, in this country, when one election ends, just like one holiday, the next one begins. So it's the end of Thanksgiving and Christmas decorations have to go up. You have to buy them. They're already talking about who's up next. It's incredible. I mean, we haven't had an inauguration yet and we're already thinking of the midterm election, the next presidential election. In a normal country, elections last for about a month. They are a marginal part of human life. In this country, where actually there's no political process, elections have taken over our minds. So we have this faux democracy where we imagine that for long periods of time we're actually in a democratic process and we, you know, basically feel proud that we're in a democracy because of this extended, protracted process. At the same time, there is no real conversation about real problems that afflict people. Now, we think of this as a democracy because two parties decided to put up candidates that were the only two considered legitimate in the election. One party, its history was basically written in 1962 by Philip K. Dick, the man in the high castle. And when I think of Trump sitting in his tower, I think of the man in the high castle. I mean, this guy has evoked the classical fascistic, you know, demon by ignoring real issues, that is to say, ignoring the real reasons why there's a hollowing out of America. And there's a hollowing out not just of America, but of the West. And if we have more time, we can talk about what that means. Instead of going into the real reasons why deindustrialization works, why going into the real reasons why people are in severe economic distress, he flies the flag, essentially, of what a scholar some years ago called the possessive investment in whiteness. In other words, we've been devalued. Our lives have been devalued. Now, this doesn't mean I don't feel for people in rural areas who've watched their family farms be taken away by corporate farming. It doesn't mean I don't feel for people who've lost their factory jobs. These are great, you know, disappointments, actually. Let's put it in those terms. Disappointments for people's understanding of how their lives should have lived out. But rather than talk about what actually made this happen, there was a great deal of winking and nodding about the value of your skin. And this was plainly there in his election campaign, and it is plainly going to come out in the way he governs. In other words, there is no way, and I don't know if you saw the leaked memo from the transition team, the Trump transition, but there's a leaked memo which has got his 200-day plan for economic policy. He's going to try to repeal NAFTA, and he's going to slap a 35 to 45% tariff on Chinese goods. Now, if this is even possible, $11 billion transacts the US-Mexico border every day. If this is even possible, Walmart would go out of business. If this is possible, the Chinese will retaliate. They'll stop buying Boeing, they'll buy Airbus, etc. They'll stop buying, you know, American high-tech goods, they'll buy more from Europe, they'll start producing their own, etc. The Chinese will retaliate. There'll be more grief inside the United States, perhaps not more in the same areas, and he's going to blow the dog whistle harder. In other words, he doesn't really have a plan for economic distress. So be careful, because the dog whistle will blow much louder when his economics fails him, because he's lied to people about his plan. The other side, we have a political party, the so-called Democratic Party, which, Mark is right, decided to concentrate more on culture rather than economics. Because after all, their standard bearer is entirely bought and sold by Wall Street, and therefore didn't have the credibility to come out there and talk about banks, finance, jobs, etc. Nobody would have believed her had she done that. So she had to talk about things like culture. You know, one of the main issues, Uditi, was vote for me. The glass ceiling will crack, right? That was the main issue, in a sense. I'm with her. That was the slogan. It wasn't we stand together. It really was I'm with her. It's her turn now. Now, the problem is that with all the important frontline issues in the United States at this time, Black Lives Matter, Movement for Black Lives, Standing Rock, etc., immigrant rights, she's on the wrong side of history. You know, you can't take a position on the Movement for Black Lives by saying, I'm with you, but I'm also with Blue Lives Matter. You can't take a position on Standing Rock by saying, let's negotiate our way out of this. You know, even Barack Obama has betrayed the people he went to twice to get votes in North Dakota. He twice visited that community. This is before the pipeline struggle began. And he said, I'm with you. And the tribal elders wrote him a letter recently, which I thought was very moving, saying, you came and gave us your word, and you betrayed your word. How can people expect that this so-called Democratic Party, by name only, this Democratic Party with no credibility on the so-called cultural issues, let's call them cultural issues, they have no credibility. Why would people come out to vote? You know, there is voter suppression, I agree with you. But why would people come out to vote? Why would people in the so-called urban areas, as they are so, you know, tentatively called, why would people in the urban areas, in other words, blacks and Latinos, come out to vote for a party that won't stand on principle against police violence? Why would people be enthusiastic? Now, imagine, and I'm going to come very close to ending, but imagine if Hillary Clinton, and this is just to play the game, okay, to play the electoral analysis game, imagine if Hillary Clinton hadn't chosen one of the most boring Democratic Party politicians, Tim Kaine, as her running mate. He barely won Virginia for her. She would have won Virginia anyway, because Virginia, basically, that votes Democratic, is the suburbs of Washington, D.C. Why did she choose this guy? Imagine if she had chosen, just to play that game, imagine if she had chosen a Latino. Would that not have been different? Because after all, we are petty people. Multiculturalism has done this to our brains. We're happy just to see, as you said, a little touch of color here and there. Suddenly, the Latino population, let's just put it in broad terms, not Puerto Ricans on the I-4 corridor, whatever, you know, the Latino population in Florida decides, well, look, there's a Latino going to be a vice president. But they don't take these communities seriously. They take them for granted. They think if we scare them, they'll vote for us. What we really want is we want the white suburban voter. And that's what we really want. And what I'm going to say to you should not be a shock. Obama is one of the coolest people in the world, horrible president, coolest person, personally, can dance. Great guy. I mean, if I was to pick somebody to spend an evening with, I'd pick Obama over many world leaders, certainly. I don't know if you read his autobiography, Dreams of My Father. It's a great section where he's in college wearing a leather jacket, reading Franz Fanon, discussing Mary Daly. You know, this guy's a cool guy. Entered the Democratic Party, basically gave himself over to full-scale turbocharged neoliberalism, became who he is. The Obama presidency is an aberration. We're returned back to normal in a way. This is the return to normal. Remember the Bush years. I mean, and let's go back to the Clinton years. Those were terrifying years for immigrants, for people of color, the Clinton years. Remember the crime bill, welfare reform ending, the Immigration Act of 1996, and then the repeal of Glass-Steagall. You know, people have a long memory. Put another Clinton on the ballot, they think of the 1990s. It's a nightmare. Finally, just the last thing in terms of slogans. I mean, John, we have something called a labor movement in the United States. When is the last time the labor movement has given us slogans that people feel inspired by? For instance, this country gave the world Haymarket, the fight for a reduced hour day, from 12 hours to 10 hours, then to 8 hours. Isn't it time we have a 6-hour day slogan, 5-hour day? Isn't it time we talk about not creating jobs, because those are impossible, and we can talk about that in the question period. Isn't it about time we talked about what life should look like? That we should have more leisure, that we should share the productivity gains, that we should not have militarism as the core of this country, that we in Northampton should not sit happily unless we have, say, a socialist on the city council. See, why is it that the whole country's left is excited when Seattle has one city councilor who's a socialist, but Northampton has zero socialists on the city council, Amherst zero socialists? You know, our elected officials here are abysmal. Why don't we run at them from the left? Push them further. We don't. That's what the right does. We are a people of no imagination. We sit back and say, at least we have decent people representing us. I don't want decent people. I want people who come there and fight for what we believe in. But we don't have that. We don't put their feet, as they say, to the fire. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Vijay. It leaves us with a lot to think about. I think we're just about ready to open it up for audience questions. So I know the note cards and the little golf pencils have been making their way around. You can either hold up your note card and we'll bring the mic to you, or you could just raise your hand.
Hi. I feel like I, like a lot of people right now, are really struggling trying to figure out what we do on a very basic level, what we do next. I'm definitely guilty of, up till now, all I ever did was vote. And I want to do more. And I've had so many conversations with colleagues, with friends who are asking me now, what can I do? And all I can tell them is, call your senators, sign these petitions. Do you have any suggestions for concrete things that we can do, and also ways that we can communicate things that are happening? Because I found out about this at the very last minute because someone shared it on a Facebook page. Like, there are not lines of communication, not at a national level, not at a local level, and I don't know how to find that. Thanks.
We should talk it.
Could I borrow a mic first one?
I'm not, you didn't ask me this question, but I can tell you that if you'd like to join the American Friends Service Committee listserv, there are clipboards with orange sheets of paper. Go ahead and sign up. And the AFSC of Western Mass does actually maintain a social justice calendar on its website, where we publicize events like this, events like the documentary screening we'll be doing in 2 weeks, and so on. But you didn't ask me. Which panelists would like to speak to that?
I think what we do is at two levels. I would say, like, the issue which a lot of people are facing is that they're waking up to realize that they don't have a we. And this is what I always say, that, you know, there's nothing that, you know, individuals can do other than write to senators, right? Or, you know, sign a petition or share something on Facebook, right? So if you're starting from the ground level, is to look at, you know, locally, where are folks? Who are your peeps? you know, and your peeps should inform what you're doing, because this is grassroots movement building, right? This cannot be dictated to you from folks around, like, you know. So it's basically, and once you have a group of peeps, you also connect to organizations who are already working, right? And strengthen. So there are national level organizations. There's Planned Parenthood needs support, ACLU needs support, right? Southern Poverty Law Center needs support. For those who can give time, give time. For those who can give money, give money. Those are often inversely proportional, right? So these are some spaces to go to. Locally, you know, there are fantastic organizers in Springfield, right? So find out who is there. There's a local group of Surge, Stand Up for Racial Justice. So there are people already working, right? So there's a lot that can be done. I think the question often is more posed as like, you know, how can I have a result quickly? And we have to get out of that, because that's not going to happen. Like, a quick result is not going to happen.
I think, yeah, one other thing I want to add real quick. As for, like, a movement that's sort of come to my attention following the election, is the movement for sanctuary cities, towns, and sanctuary campuses, mm-hmm. Which I think will be sort of particularly important given sort of Trump's immigration policies. And I know that at least Amherst College and a large number of colleges and universities across the country are planning sort of a day of action tomorrow, and essentially sort of trying to contact sort of immigration activists in your community and seeing if what they have done on this and what they're working on in regards to this is a sort of directly relevant thing to do.
Mark, can you explain that concept of a sanctuary city or a sanctuary campus?
Yeah. My vague understanding of it is the idea that essentially it's meant to provide sanctuary for undocumented immigrants from the Immigration and Customs Enforcers, essentially to prevent people from being deported. I don't know exactly sort of the legal justification for it, but as I understand it, like, it's something that... Yeah.
Can I speak to that? So sanctuary basically is, the need for sanctuary is Obama's gift, right? So it's the changes Obama brought in immigration policy basically led to a situation of the creation of ICE, and which is an agency which, through a set of procedures, it became legal, even essential, as instructed at the federal level, that you could be asked for your immigration papers for any minor kind of, you know, violation of, you know, speeding or, you know, traffic violation or anything, right? So any minor violation could be linked to your kind of, like, if you call the cops for domestic violence, they can come and tell you, well, by the way, are you legal, right? So, and what the sanctuary cities do is that they pass some sort of a local legal arrangement, either through the mayor or, you know, the city council or whatever, saying that we are not going to implement this, right? It's not going to be compulsory in this city, right? And that's so Amherst, Holyoke, Springfield, Northampton are all sanctuary cities. But the concept of a sanctuary campus, to my knowledge, doesn't exist. It's something which folks are fighting for. So the two are very different kind of concepts.
I very much agree with what's been said, or what could be and should be done. I just want to kind of underline that we live in a situation which demands a radical systematic change of society, and then it is absolutely not enough to turn towards the elected politicians. We have to mobilize in such a way that, to my knowledge, is the only thing that's ever produced radical social change. And that is people going in mobilizations to direct action and demanding these changes for regimes that have to bow for that or fall. So the kind of things that are needed are direct actions, are mobilizing for the longer time with movements. But I think we can also focus on campaigns for shorter terms to get certain results that build that the momentum for such movements.
Yeah, so I've got a couple of, I've got three questions lined up right now. How and to what extent can Trump dismantle the environmental protection agencies and or legislative measures we have worked so hard and so long to put into effect?
So why don't you do all three?
Yeah.
Then, during a recent interview with Stephen Colbert, Bernie Sanders strongly requested not to label, please write clearly and legibly on your cards, please. To rank those who voted for Trump as racists. He argued that it might lead to further alienation, and it's important to engage with them. And Professor Sen, that your response is requested for that one. And what specific strategic policies can we pursue that A, have hope of passage under Republicans, and B, that we can build a movement around? I think of rebuilding the energy grid, for example. And I'll come around and grab some more cards.
Okay, fine. I'll do the last one. I'm so glad that you called my essay in the Gazette a comedy. But actually, there was something real in it. Which is that, so Trump has said, I stayed up till 3 in the morning. Who watched the 3 in the morning phone call? Yes, you and I. Yeah. Who else? Everybody else went to sleep. You woke up to the new reality. By the way, just to say before I get into this, I was actually, sorry, I understand the worry of the Trump presidency, but I was quite taken by the amount of sadness people had for Hillary Clinton's loss. In other words, I didn't realize so many of my friends actually wanted her to win. That is, they wanted her to win, not Trump to lose. I found that interesting. You know, that actually interested me. I'm just speaking, you know, in journalistic terms, I actually thought that there would be people on some sort of left liberal continuum who were more inclined to the defeat of Trump than actually the victory of Hillary Clinton. But I was wrong, and that was, you know. No, I know there were a lot of people like that. There were lots of people like that. But there were also people on that continuum that actually wanted Hillary Clinton to win. And I understand some of the, you know, ideas of the glass ceiling, etc. But really, they actually wanted her to win. And that surprised me. But, yeah, sorry.
I just want to respond.
Please, yeah.
Let's use the microphone just because there are folks who are going to be listening to this.
Yeah. Please. Yeah. Please.
Yeah, so, you know, I think it really speaks to a much larger problem, what you just pointed out. Yeah. And the problem is that we live in these bubbles, and we surround ourselves with like-minded people, and that's been, you know, Facebook's been talking about, the press have been talking about that. And, you know, I'm a pragmatist, and I think, you know, there's a very, very immediate danger right now to people with dark skin, people with big noses, people who are immigrants who with an accent. And I don't think we have the time to build a movement to deal with that. So, so I guess just give me 2 more minutes
please,
to finish
please,
my point.
Please, go ahead.
So I see three things that have really unleashed this national it of ours. One is these bubbles that we're in, and that's you know, the proliferation of the web and communications and all that.
Go ahead, please.
Oh, sorry about that. There's also been such an erosion of our educational system, right? Because now we have the false equivalency of evolutionism and creationism being taught in the schools. And now we think we can question the scientific evidence about climate change, where 97% of all scientists actually agree that there is human-driven climate change. So that's education, bubbles, and then there is this huge juggernaut of right-wing propaganda machine. And that scares me probably more than anything else, because I was born in the Soviet Union. I spent the first 13 years of my life under a totalitarian regime where propaganda was the only news. So I think these are, you know, these are the three sort of kingdoms that we need to dismantle. But I feel a tremendous sense of urgency to actually do something to protect my sisters and brothers, and frankly myself, a Jewish immigrant lesbian, and my family. So I just wanted to sort of put that out there as an issue or so.
Yeah, no. What you said is all correct, and I agree with you. But that still, to me, would be the need to defeat Trump. You know, I was in agreement with that. And I understand that it's a silly thing. You might say, listen, it's a silly thing. It's a binary choice. To defeat Trump, you have to elect Hillary Clinton. I understand that. But you can have a vote which says, I want to defeat him, and not a vote which says, I want her to be the president. That's the difference I'm making. In other words, you know, this is the Wall Street militarist. So the choice is terrible. And either way, at least the world is going to lose. You know, in the United States, some pockets would perhaps have preferred to have a liberal be the president, but the world is going to lose either way. You know, it's going to, some countries, I wrote the night of the election, some country is going to get bombed whoever gets to win this election. You know, that's a given. So it's the enthusiasm that I was just marking. I found that interesting, at least for people on the left that would be enthusiastic about electing her. I can see very much the need to defeat him. But to elect her, I mean, anyway, that's could be. I live in a big bubble as well. Although I had been to a bunch of Trump rallies, and those were interesting. That was very much outside my comfort zone.
I bet.
This idea of what specific policies could be pushed, I think, is a very interesting one. And this comes to, I think, the idea of what the reaction should be to this presidency. You know, I would say that Mr. Trump in that 3 o'clock speech said, I'm going to build infrastructure. Now, infrastructure is going to cost minimum $1 trillion, if not the complete bill, which is over $3 trillion. He's not going to be able to raise this money. Their growth plan is largely illusionary. You know, tax cuts, cut on regulation. Somehow, this tariff wall goes up, and then Americans will start working again. It doesn't work like that. You know, there's been a deterioration of skills, manufacturing skills. You're going to have people learn how to do this. I just give you a statistic. From the Great Depression to now, 11 million jobs have been created. 8 million of them went to college graduates. Almost 3 million went to people with an associate's degree. And only 80,000 went to people who only had a high school degree. You know, you've got a serious problem here. That the jobs that are going to come aren't actually going to come to people who Trump calls the forgotten Americans. That problem is endemic. And therefore, the violence that's going to be has been unleashed is going to actually have much greater impact in the period, because they're not going to be able to actually put their agenda forward. So now you have to think, do you fight to push that agenda forward? I think the left, whatever remains of it, if Keith Ellison becomes the head of the DNC, let's say, whatever remains of a left in organized democratic politics and outside, should fight very hard for infrastructure rebuilding. Should fight very hard for the only possible way to fund infrastructure, which is massive tax on the rich. I mean, we need to talk openly about massive tax on the rich. Not this thing about, you know, we'll plug loopholes. I mean, where is the politics that just says the rich are sitting on too much productivity and too much wealth? They don't have a right to it. They're unpatriotic. They're against humanity. Why don't we talk openly about this? Instead, we also inhabit this world of, you know, Democratic Party, you know, lobbyists, or not lobbyists, what are they called? Image consultants or people? You know, these people who tell them, I keep forgetting who they are. Spin doctors. No, they are professionals. They hang on. Consultants. Consultants. Talk about plugging loopholes. Don't talk about taxing the rich. You know, they focus grouped it out. Yeah. No. I'm going.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's cycle back to the second audience question, which was directed
specifically to... I had a direct question.
Yeah.
Okay, so quickly, like, I mean, environmental protection, I know very little, but from what I've been hearing, I think people are scared everything's going to go. And as for other things which are legally sanctioned, I mean, that's going to be a hard one. That's going to be not the next 2 years, but the 2 years after that. I mean, that's the sense I get. And I think that is where we are really, forgive my language, screwed. because he's going to get the nominate the judges, and this is where actually where the primary focus of activism has been to, like, we really have to look at how effective activism which relies on law is going to be starting 2018. So that's a question which, you know, folks who have the resources, who understand the system, who have, you know, friends in ACLU who have been working, like, that's the real work which needs to happen. Like, we need to ask this question that is this strategy still effective? Or do we need to look at other things, right? And I don't have the answer because I don't have the expertise to speak to that. As for not labeling people as racist, those who voted for, you know, Trump, you know, I mean, I come from a country where entire villages don't vote because they know, entire villages. That's a protest vote. You know, they use expletives and say, you know, you folks have betrayed us. Don't vote. And as we saw, a lot of people were not excited. They didn't vote. A lot of people were, you know, wanted to give a protest vote, you know, which I too kind of Jill Stein, which I thought it was too risky to do that, but I respect that. You know, you have a politics of a certain kind of ethics. I really struggle to understand why your protest vote had to be for a known sexual predator. Forget about the racism. Why is that okay? And this is the part of the election which I cannot understand. The sheer number of white women who voted for Trump. I was like, really? Really, really? So in terms of, you know, racism, I often tell our students that, look, if we haven't done some work decolonizing, the chances are we are all racist. Because I'm a historian, right? We have had 200 years of empire or more. Well, now we have informal empire. God knows how many years of slavery, how many years of segregation, and we've undone it all in 40 years. Done. Well done. There are no ideas which have remained in us, which we are not overtly racist, but don't make sense without racism. I mean, that doesn't make sense to me. I'll give you an example from my place. I grew up somehow thinking, somehow Hindus are superior to Muslims, somehow. We're kind of more progressive, you know? We were all told, find an educated Indian, even with, you know, progressive parents who was not told, yeah, go marry whoever you want, don't bring a Muslim home. Find me one. That is the kind of racism I'm talking about. It doesn't mean I don't have Muslim friends. It doesn't mean I'm going to call for them to be killed. But it does mean I somehow believe I'm superior. Now, I've done work to undo that. But I still have vestiges of it. And the most useful thing I heard a working class, you know, tall, lanky, white British dyke tell me was that, you know, God, I've worked very hard to get this shit out of me. I don't know how much of it is still left. So, and there's also another kind of metaphor where people say, you know, it's not like, you know, if you tell somebody, you know, your teeth is dirty, like, how dare you, I cleaned it 20 years ago. I mean, look at the media climate we live in. Look at what we are fed. You have to clean your teeth every day. But racism, no, once. We've decolonized once 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, we are done. Nobody can ever have any racism left. It's ridiculous. So I'm not labeling anybody, but the folks who are coming from the place that, are you labeling me as racist, are treating racism as a contagion. Are looking for some kind of purity for themselves, and that's not a way forward anywhere. Like, even if you are kind of any kind of faith, you don't believe in God once. The believer doesn't never revisit their belief, right? That's how it works everywhere.
Thank you. Mark or Stellan, would either of you like to jump in to answer one of the questions we've asked so far? Otherwise, I'm sure we've got more brewing in the audience.
Yeah, I mean, I could just, there we go. Just to follow up one thing on what Professor Sen said about white women, it sort of like falls into the way I understood that was that not only, not just did white women sort of vote with their racial identity as opposed to sort of their gender identity, but voted with like a broader cultural identity, which was the sort of culture that I was talking about earlier of the sort of Midwest and South of these sort of coal country and of sort of former industrialized areas, the Rust Belt and sort of all these areas that have been left behind. They sort of prioritized that, whether consciously or not, over the sort of gender discrimination that Trump represents. And that's something that, you know, definitely does need to be engaged with and does need to, and it that is a sort of a racist act and also a sexist act, I think. Someone said internalized misogyny. I don't know that that's the answer to everything or that it's like the sole solution, but there's like a part of that within anyone who voted for Trump, but also, I mean, most of the rest of us as well.
Thank you very much, Mark. Jeff is out in the audience to take our next question. I do just want to remind audience members to keep their questions short, just about 1 minute, so that we can hear from the panelists. Thank you.
All right, so I want to start by thanking the panelists, and I want to return to the idea of sanctuary cities. So when I first met Jeff and John Weissman, I was it was my first year at Amherst, and we started talking about sanctuary cities, because in New York, I worked as an organizer with undocumented workers. And before I started classes, there was a raid in Springfield. And we were talking about that conversation of what we could do at Amherst to start, you know, a sanctuary city. And we met with some of the folks in Amherst in the elder, what are they called, the folks that serve in the council? No, the eldermen or something, I forgot. There we go, aldermen, there we go. So we met with some of those folks and we started an organization at Amherst called In Solidarity of Immigrants. Jamie from Hampshire and some other folks were part of that. And I wanted to return to sanctuary cities because the idea of sanctuary cities is very different from where the immigrant movement, as we understand it now, started in 2006. Where people were talking about no immigrant is, no person is illegal, no human being is illegal. So sanctuary cities became part of a strategy to approach immigration as a piecemeal, you know, problem. So when you hear Trump saying, we're gonna deport 2 million to 3 million people, and we're just talking about the criminals, that kind of goes back to that piecemeal approach. And it goes back to the idea of the dreamers. And then it became the focus on families. So forget about the folks that are undocumented, that are queer. Forget about the folks that are legal residents that you know, have been in this country and had some drug offense 20 years ago. Now they're gonna get deported back to Haiti. The immigrant movement became divided and it was fractured. And a lot of that is also true of the left in general. So my mother was a United Steel worker. Her factory was closed where she worked at a paper mill in Jackson Heights, Queens. And then it was sent over to the Bay Shore in Long Island. And when I asked her about the election, you know, she said, I'm not going to vote for Trump because he hates Latinos. So she's very proud of being a Latina woman. So that was it for her. But she said that she did identify with him talking about jobs, with him talking straight. So for a lot of working class people, a lot of carpenters that are Latinos, that are African-American, the call for jobs was real. So I think that when we talk about the left, we have to see it as comprised of people with multiple interests. And those economic interests, unfortunately, they're not really kind of surfaced in the conversation today. And I feel like they were somehow undercut by just focusing them so exclusively on white working class voters. The working class is made up of a lot of different people, and those people are complicated. And I just wanted to note that because I still work as an organizer, and I try to meet people where they're at. I try organizing Latinos, and they tell me African Americans are, you know, terrible, they're criminals, and I can't tell them, you know what, get your PC straight because I can't work with you. No, I got to meet them there. And through the process of struggle, they get to learn about their racism. But I feel that the moralizing that happened in the election, like, oh, Donald Trump is just so sexist, how can anyone vote for him? A lot of people actually identify with that. So I think that there needs to be a lot of organizing that needs to happen. I would like to hear from you what you think that could look like, and not organizing that already presumes that people are, you know, just internalized, have internalized racism or misogyny, but that people are hurting in this country. And they found a demagogue that somehow, you know, could channel that frustration. And the left was not there to somehow capitalize on those, you know, demands for better jobs, for better schools. Like, there's so many things that people voted for Trump, misguided, however they may be. But I think we can dismiss that.
Let me just get one more question on this side of the room before I go to the other side of the room and you answer those questions.
So actually, this question really is is related to what he just said, and that was to please comment on the possibilities for a Pablo Freire popular-type education, popular education, such as at the Highlander Center. It seems like when you were talking about us getting our strategy together and our vision of what a new world should be, this could be one way we could really do it.
Is there someone who'd like to speak to that first?
Sure.
There's one more question. Jeff, did you want to grab one question first and then we'll... Do you want to grab one question in the middle first and then we'll get panelists to possible?
I'm interested in how many people in this group listen every day to Democracy Now! We have to boycott the corporate media, and that means what? Also listening to WXOJ, Valley Free Radio, that has many good programs, but we clearly need a jobs program to put America back to work, repairing the infrastructure of this country. Things that Jill Stein recommended is what I feel we need.
Panelists' response?
Sure. Let's go to Stellan. Okay. Yeah, I'll try to address both issues here. So, I think that popular education in the form of what we saw in Highlander that was essential for the growth of the civil rights movement plays a key role here. So I will just give an example that during the ANC struggle in South Africa against apartheid, what that was an institutionalized racist dictatorship, already in the 50s, they organized through popular education in local discussion groups in neighborhoods, actually about 1 million people to discuss the future constitution of a free South Africa. And that freedom charter from 52 was the basis of one of the more radical constitutions we have in the world today from South Africa. So I think we need to think visionary, and we need to think about what to do now. I mean, it should be possible for us to keep these two thoughts in mind at the same time. So the visions are about how we deal with the immediate threats. I think it's really impossible to have a left or liberals or whatever you want to call it that is focused on only defending against the excesses of capitalism, racism, homophobia, and sexism, and now neo-fascism with Trump. There has to be a work on developing our visions. And for me, that's the kind of the answer of how to reach people that were brought in by the demagogue Trump. I think if we can meet people across different lines and talk about the concerns about being unemployed, the concerns of being poor while still working full time, if we can talk about the worries about how money is really guiding the politics in this country, then you could also find common ground with people from so-called the other side. Yeah.
Should we just go down the line?
I actually want to say thank you, because the second question was not really a question. It was a very important kind of point raised about how the immigration movement is fractured. So, yeah. So, thank you for that. And just to briefly, in terms of envisioning, I think one of the very important things which also, you know, Vijay mentioned, and it links up to envisioning, one of the problems in America, like I'm still a relatively recent, you know, migrant, people do not have time. And people do not have time because, you know, the American wage has been declining in real terms since the 80s. And, like, statistically, Americans work more than any other nation in the world. You know, yeah, like daily in terms of, you know, work hours. So to envision, to organize, to meet, you know, people, and especially working people, you know, they need time. So in some ways, you know, we kind of have to create these, you know, like basic, you know, like look at, create the conditions, which, you know, in corporate speak, forgive me for using it, there are times where you're right, in corporate speak, they're doing this thing called, you know, ecosystem building. Like there are entire organizations which do ecosystem building, which acknowledge that, you know, the ecosystem doesn't exist in this place for, you know, what we want to do to take off, right? So currently I would say that the ecosystem which we need to have this kind of envisioning and meeting and building doesn't quite exist in most parts of this country. And I think the first step would be to think about how do we create, you know, that where people actually have time. People have a different relationship to, you know, like where they live, how long do they commute for, you know, how is that even possible? And like within those constraints, right? So that's one. And the other thing about, you know, the labeling racist, what resonates with people is that, I mean, don't get me wrong. Like, I never kind of, you know, am for, you know, every time I say that, you know, somebody is racist, I say, and by the way, I am too. I mean, that's my understanding. So don't get me wrong that I'm not saying that, you know, you, like, if I encounter, you encounter, you know, organizing somebody saying something really objectionable, you tell that person, rah, you've not reached kind of my state of radical perfection, therefore go away. But I think what I'm coming from is more like, you know, there's a tendency in democratic language, which is peddled by mainstream media, to call whatever is in a majority, quote unquote, legitimate concerns, right? And I saw this during Brexit, I've seen this in India, I'm seeing this in USA, right? I'm like, that is not, you cannot, you engage with people, but at the same time, just because people who have been fed certain things and out of pain are saying certain things, you don't track back and say, oh, because you're saying, because you're feeling this, your feelings need to be validated. That doesn't seem progressive to me. So that's the distinction I'm talking about, if that makes sense, right? You know, you don't stop engaging, but you also don't go the other way and start validating things which you ideologically feel are wrong or not acceptable. So there has to be a balance somewhere.
So yeah, I guess I want to also look at the point about the sort of the non-white working class, and what was something that was interesting to me about that was about the election itself was that actually a significant number of people of color did end up voting for Trump in larger proportions amongst, I think, every racial group: white people, black people, Latinos. And Asians in greater numbers than had voted, significantly greater numbers in some cases than had voted for Mitt Romney in 2012. And I think a lot of that's because these groups almost felt like they were sort of taken for granted by the Democratic Party and by Hillary Clinton, whose pitch to them was, I'm not Trump. And like Vijay was saying, never sort of extended beyond that into a sort of radical embracing of the issues that really mattered to them, whether sort of it was immigration issues or issues with racial justice. And I think going off of another thing that Vijay had said, the idea of the sort of labor movement having failed in this election and sort of in a broader sense over the past few decades, I think something that the labor movement can do to bring together the non-white working class and the working class in a quest, not just for sort of economic justice, but for broader social justice, is the sense of like social justice unionism, the sort of thing where like the Chicago Teachers Union took a day-long strike to protest police brutality. which had nothing to do with, you know, ostensibly sort of in a direct sense, nothing to do with teaching or with the Chicago public school system, but in part, you know, impacted their students and their teachers in very personal ways. And more broadly, unions, especially large unions, sort of are this organizing power that ought to be taken advantage of by the left to accomplish not just the goals within sort of the economic justice sphere, but within sort of immigrant rights and racial justice and everything else.
So we'll hear from Vijay, and then we've just got two more questions.
You know, your point is right to what I'm interested in, which is to say that the Trump agenda, which is putatively economic, it appears to be an economic agenda, at least what was leaked today, was all about trade, about tariffs, you know, it's kind of Alexander Hamilton-ish report on manufacturers, very similar. The problem they'll face is that we no longer live in national economies, that the United States is integrated into a global commodity chain. It's very hard to abruptly break out of this global commodity chain. We've seen small countries attempt it, and then they've been penalized by the IMF and the World Bank. Nothing of this scale has been seen before. So the disruptive effects of this are going to be enormous. And I fear, therefore, that the attacks on those who are deemed to be different will be quite sharp in the period coming. But that's precisely the reason why people who are on the broad left should articulate an actual economic agenda. And let me just quickly give you three parts to an agenda like that. Most of this is already in our discussions, but we don't often put it together. You know, one is, it's true that American labor or American people work very hard. Productivity gains have been taken by the rich. They basically seize the productivity gains from that hard work. At the same time, American labor is bizarrely expensive. And the reason it's expensive is that everything is privatized. You have to get your own health insurance. You have to get your own insurance on your car. You have to get your own insurance on your house. You know, the insurance payments, that burdens that are carried by the average American is extraordinarily high. So if we, one of the themes that we have to push for much, very hard, and I'll explain why this is important, is for things like universal health care, free college tuition, public transportation should be free, or widely available, things like that. This should be really quite fiercely on the agenda. How do you pay for it? What I said earlier, we've got to come back to directly confronting the reason that productivity gains have been seized by the rich. They are absorbing all the profits in society. They need to be directly challenged. They have to pay higher taxes. And then what this will provide for is space to talk about things like a six-hour day, space to talk about things like workers are human beings. We need to build a society. We don't need a jobs program. We need a society program. We need to imagine what it's like to live in a society, not just to be working, working, working. You know, that was what the Nazis put up on top of their concentration camp. Arbeit macht frei. Work makes you free. Work doesn't make you free. Freedom makes you free. So we should fight for a new society. We have to Now, look, you can turn around and say you are idealistic. This is ridiculous. You know who was the most idealistic candidate this election? Trump. He fed an idealistic agenda to people which he cannot realize. This agenda is actually realizable. His agenda is not realizable. His agenda where he says, I'll bring jobs back, etc. He basically provided something which is completely in the realm of ideals, which cannot has no material content. You cannot walk away from the global commodity chain so easily.
We've got one question in person, and then we've got two on cards. And then, like the polar ice caps, we're sort of melting in here, so we're going to bring this to an end.
I'll just ask one out of a million questions. I keep getting different answers on this question. Does Obama have the legal right to appoint Merrick Garland to the Supreme Court if the Senate does nothing?
That's a quick one. Can anyone speak to that really quick?
No idea.
I can. I mean, there's sort of been a lot of talk about that, and I don't know, it's not a sort of yes or no question. People have sort of said you can interpret the Constitution such that the Senate has now waived their right to appoint Merrick Garland to the, or to make a sort of judgment, and then Obama can just sort of go ahead with the appointment, but there's sort of no case law or sort of legal basis for that, but nothing that necessarily defies that either.
two more questions. And I'm going to give them both to you at the same time. So we need to decolonize, yes. How do we do that? Is it possible to have this done not just individually, but also collectively, such as through various social movements, Black Lives Matter, unions, socialist groups, etc.? That's one question. And then the other question that we're going to end on is, where do you see glimmers of hope?
I think they're the same question, really, as far as I look at it. Like, you know, I think we have to get away from, you know, binaries where it's like, you know, the, do we attack the electoral system or do we actually work at the grassroots to try and change the political culture? I don't think these are, you know, contradictory. And I think, you know, yes, Bernie Sanders, you know, was maneuvered out, but, you know, Jeremy Corbyn won. I mean, they tried their level best against him. He still won. So we are actually living in a world where politics as usual is just not holding. Whether you're an outsider or not, you have to either pose to be an outsider or be an outsider to get people out voting. Because remember, Obama also, that was his card. He was an outsider. He didn't vote for the war, right? And he promised transformation, as was Bernie, and he got people excited, as did Trump, right? So I think there is hope there, there is possibility there, but I think at what level people can engage, whether it's at, you know, shifting grassroots culture, or it's actually kind of attacking, kind of, you know, focusing on the Democratic Party and the way this kind of, it is systematically totally flawed, I think it varies depending on what resources people have. Like, not everybody has the resources to do both, right? So I think we, for us to kind of move forward, and, you know, we have to stop looking at these things as, you know, somehow choices or binaries, or how, you know, one distracts from, you know, the other, if that, and really think of those kind of, you know, like broad-based alliances, right? You know, where you have a basic sense that, you know, okay, this is kind of, you know, there's a line in the sand and we are doing different stuff, but we are roughly on the same side, so to speak. And I think I forgot, like, decolonization, how do we do that? Yeah, that's how we do that. We do that. I mean, I'm a big fan of talking to each other. We talk to each other based on that, you know, we build stuff, and we stop judging people, and we just, you know, we stop occupying the moral high ground. I'm so sick of it. And this is a particular problem of the left, I'm sorry to say. It's a particular problem of the progressives, I'm sorry to say. I'm just coming from, you know, a Facebook discussion where a group of more senior organizers were barfing on young people from, you know, Holyoke Community College who organized a Springfield March because they cooperated with the police, because guess what? They didn't have an adequate understanding of the police being racist. I'm like, did you talk to these people? Did you call them in? Did you, you know, how many conversations did you have before you publicly recoat their coat and start barfing on them? I was lectured on my inadequate progressiveness. You know, so this is the culture we are dealing with. This is where I despair, right? And we have to, you know, we have to stop seeing people who are on the same team as opponents and, you know, have these conversations, because, and this, I totally agree with, you know, what you're saying. So, I mean, I've been called everything which is possible to be called, actually. I mean, name it. Everything. Because if you start fighting with people, the assumption is that I actually don't know, and therefore I have to be named and called out.
So, glimmers of hope, etc. You know, the first thing is, you know, you said, who is the we? Well, if we take this from the planet's perspective, there is certainly a decline of American power. And that really, from a planetary perspective, may not be a bad thing. The United States is going to isolate itself under the Trump presidency. New centers of authority will develop. There's a rebalancing of the world order. It's bad for inside America, perhaps, because when world empires begin to deteriorate, it's okay. It's okay. Would you like to say something? Huh?
Putin
No, it's not a question.
You think of the ones who are emerging.
No,
sorry.
It's not. You see, I mean, it's a long conversation.
I agree.
No, go ahead.
No. I didn't want to say it. I agree with what you're saying.
Go ahead.
No, sorry, I agree totally with what you're saying, that it's a fundamental change. But I was making a face because the visions of the leaders that are emerging started coming before my face, and that scared the hell out of me. Sorry.
It's okay. I mean, I'm happy to. You know, you just said we should have good conversations, so I'm happy to have a conversation. I prefer that you weren't just making faces. Sorry. It would be easier. I know. I'm just happy to engage with you. I don't mean that rebalancing is a good thing. Necessarily that it's a progressive thing, but it's just happening. You know, it's a process that's been underway for a great deal of time. That doesn't mean that new centers of power are necessarily good or socialist or whatever. They could be as retrograde. But there is now some complexity. The age of unipolarity is going to end. And Obama has been, in a sense, presiding over that age of decline. And I think, you know, Trump is going to be part of this decline. There's no way a new American century can be inaugurated. That's perfectly true. The problem is, I pulled out of an old bookshelf of mine, Edward Gibbon's, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, just in a way after this election to get away from things like Facebook. I thought it would be a good idea to read a book, you know. So I read Gibbon's Decline and Fall, bits of it, not all of it. And, you know, when empires collapse, they really undergo, they are like dragons who are wounded. They hurt a lot of people. They bomb a lot of people. They destroy their own kind. They eat their own kind. So as Rosa Luxemburg said, you know, the choice before you is socialism or barbarism. And because there's no real socialist or progressive movement strong enough anywhere on the planet to capture the hopes and imaginations of people, we're in for a very long period of barbarism. But barbarism cannot succeed. And to me, that's a glimmer of hope. Barbarism just cannot succeed. It will be defeated. And it has to be defeated by people like us coming to these, you know, conversations, gathering together, trying to understand what's the next way forward. I think in these kind of, we should have these events regularly. In these kind of gatherings, we build up our own hope. We look at each other, make eye contact, feel that we're not alone. It's a deeply isolating society. And social media is not an antidote to isolation. We should gather more often. We should plan events. We should plan actions. You know, I take a great deal of comfort in those young people coming out on the streets. Why? When Obama was elected, there were lots of grassroots groups that came out on the street and protested. And then the AstroTurf came in. The Koch brothers came in. They created the Tea Party. You know, it's something to take from that experience. So many young people are on the street now. We need to make our kind of Tea Party. You know, we need to organize into something quite powerful, which doesn't just, as the Tea Party showed us, doesn't just attack the Democrats. They attack their own so-called party. You know, they went after the Republicans. And here, you know, the Democratic Party gets a free pass.
Mark, last words.
I guess first on the sort of decolonized point, just another addition is like educating yourself through listening to people, through engaging with people, but also through reading. There are lots of really good books that can help you sort of like, not that like, so I'm thinking from my perspective as a white guy, I'm not going to necessarily be able to fully understand what it's like to live life as a black person in the United States, but to try and get glimmers of these issues and trying to sort of understand like the aspects of these issues that I can't see just by reading and watching the news. As for glimmers of hope, I someone said Elizabeth Warren, but I feel like I want to disagree with that. I don't necessarily see any glimmers of hope within like sort of electoral politics. I think there will hopefully be sort of an electoral backlash in 2018, and hopefully there will be a Democratic sort of Senate at least. But it's not something that is going to necessarily lead to sort of a new progressive era in the United States. If your sole focus is electoral politics alone. So I think, like Vijay, my glimmer of hope is the people protesting the streets and the slogan, not my president, not because I think that Donald Trump isn't the president. I mean, he's going to be the president. But the sense of sort of reestablishing democracy, not within the sort of framework of electoral politics, but within the framework of direct action and within the framework of sort of protest, but also organizing sort of in opposition to the government or in opposition to sort of the establishment.
What direct action are you talking about? Are you talking in circles? Are you talking about armed struggle? I'm not talking about armed struggle. I'm talking about protests.
Direct action. And you don't like Elizabeth Warren? Don't you think she would be a step in the right direction?
No.
Progress doesn't come overnight.
That's settled. That's settled.
An ongoing process.
So I agree that Elizabeth Warren would be better, for sure. But I don't think that that's sort of the type of progress that is necessarily going to be the quickest or most effective way to resist a Trump presidency.
For example. What's the most effective way?
So, yeah, the essential idea is protests, and I was going to talk about, again, sanctuary campuses, sanctuary cities, these sorts of direct... and which is to a certain extent sort of legislative or electoral, but it's much more localized politics and much more localized democratization in resistance to a government that sort of seeks to oppress, you know, large swaths of people.
I think you're confused. That's what I think.
You're being obnoxious. That's what I think.
Agreed.
You're being extremely obnoxious. I'm sorry, sir, but you're being extremely obnoxious.
All right. We're going to have one last set of words from Stellan. And then I would, and then we will go home. Professor Sen was just suggesting that if you still have questions, if you still have thoughts that you want to jot down, we'll just designate a basket out there so at least we can pool them in some kind of tangible marketplace of ideas. Let's just get one final set of closing remarks from Stellan, and then we'll close it out.
All right. Okay. So I think firstly, if we want to decolonize, we need to recognize that we are still part of colonialization. And I think that is impossible in this country without understanding how genocide against indigenous people are still going on, and how slavery has been transformed into incarceration in prisons, and how the idea that U.S. people and the U.S. nation is exceptional in the world and has the right to be exceptional in its consumption and its dominance in the world is also part of these continuing colonizing patterns. And this we need to recognize in the way that we also take in how that has affected us as human beings and the way we live our lives here and now. And I think Standing Rock and our solidarity with the people that are struggling there is a very clear example of how we could do it differently. On the last point of around hope, I think we have to recognize we live in an extremely dangerous time, but it is also already clear that the threat of Trump and what all he represents is also mobilizing a stronger resistance. So the question for me is then just how do we facilitate that resistance to grow into a people power that is actually able to take the initiative away from these corrupt politicians within both the Democrats and the Republicans, and where we could get more progressive candidates coming out. And I think visions and strategy are key for this. We have to work on the visions, we have to develop strategies. And I think, for a country like United States that is spending more than 50% of the collected military spending in the world, of all other nations, 50%, of course there are resources. Of course there are resources to do something else. And of course a united people is having the power. So I think we have to build around creating unity alliances and creating resistance against the elites. But that's where it's a long-term struggle.
Thank you so much. Let's just thank our panelists one more time. We've got Professor Vijay Prashad, Marc Daalder, Professor Uditi Sen, and Professor Stellan Vinthagen. Thank you so much, and thank you, everyone. Have a great night.